I want to show you something pretty incredible at the top of this mountain. So I'm making my way up. It's about a 4,000 foot climb. And this entire time, I've been absolutely surrounded by the Ice Age. Let me show you what I mean.
Norway is a place built by ice. For a very long time, glaciers have moved across this landscape, advancing, retreating, and flowing downhill. They carve rock away from the land they pass over, leaving behind depressions called cirques, ridges called arêtes, mountains called horns, and long scratches in the rock. They flow through valleys, smoothing them out into this U-shape with steep walls and a flat base. Some of these valleys fill with water, forming the iconic Norwegian fjords. All of the rock carved away is carried by the glaciers and deposited downstream. They spit out piles of debris at their edges, forming long ridges called moraines. And they leave behind boulders, so many boulders, and in weird places, like the tops of mountains, or hundreds of kilometers from where they originated. If you know what to look for, you'll find these features everywhere, not just at the edge of glaciers, but all across Norway. About 20,000 years ago, ice covered all of Scandinavia, along with vast stretches of Europe and North America. It buried Scotland, Seattle, New York City. Since then, the ice has retreated, leaving behind all of this evidence of its former extent. Today, this evidence is impossible to miss. But just 200 years ago, its origin was a complete mystery. These features were often attributed to a flood, and the idea of Europe being buried under ice seemed absurd. I want to tell you about the first scientists to figure out how these landscapes formed and why the Earth froze. A figure whose work is among the most significant in the entire study of the Earth, but whose name has been largely forgotten. The first person to see the Ice Age, hiding in plain sight. Alright, it's the early 1800s, and it's a weird time for science. Europe is on its way out of the Little Ice Age, a 500-year-long cold period that saw glaciers advancing, oceans freezing, famines and storms killing hundreds of thousands across Europe, and Vikings and Inuit driven out of the Arctic. For centuries in Europe, mountains and glaciers have been seen as places of danger and evil, but that attitude is changing. Explorers are climbing higher, venturing farther abroad and farther north. Almost all of the Earth's land has been mapped, with two big exceptions: these massive ice sheets covering Greenland and Antarctica. The Industrial Revolution is not just changing society and politics, but creating a renewed demand to understand the Earth, and the field of geology is advancing every single day. Scientists all across Europe are looking at the landscapes around them and trying to figure out how they formed. They're seeing some weird things, boulders in places that don't make much sense, and long scratches across the Earth. For centuries, one theory has won out, that these landscapes were created by water, tsunamis, great storms, or a flood. One of the most influential geology books at the time is Thomas Burnet's Sacred Theory of the Earth, published in 1681. He describes a, quote, paradise Earth, existing thousands of years ago, completely flat with perpetual heat and sunshine. Baking in the hot sun, the Earth's crust has dried out and cracked, allowing water stored underground to erupt onto the surface in a catastrophic flood, carving today's mountains, valleys, and oceans. Hideous stains on the previously perfect Earth. Some theories are a bit closer, suggesting that these boulders were dropped by icebergs floating over this landscape during a time of higher sea levels. A few geologists are getting really close, studying glaciers high in the Alps and beginning to suspect that they had something to do with these boulders and scratches. At the same time, in a Swiss village not far from the Alps, Louis Agassiz is collecting plants and fossils, dead set on becoming a scientist. He studies in Zurich, Heidelberg, and Munich, earning a degree in medicine and a PhD in zoology, then goes to Paris to study fossils under Georges Cuvier. A few years earlier, Cuvier had published a discourse on the revolutions of the surface of the globe, proposing that species and landscapes didn't evolve gradually. Extinctions and geological processes were the result of a handful of large cataclysms in the Earth's history. In 1836, Agassiz takes a trip to the Swiss Alps and visits Jean de Charpentier. Charpentier has been doing fieldwork, finding moraines, boulders, and scratched rocks all over Europe. These landforms are similar to the ones he's found next to glaciers in the Alps, and he suspects they were left by much larger glaciers in the past. He takes Agassiz out, shows him the evidence, and it clicks. Agassiz returns home and immediately begins reading more about this, seeing reports of similar landscapes all across Europe. He puts all of those reports together and proposes his theory the next year. A time of extreme cold in the Earth's past, with ice extending from the North Pole all across Europe and North America. And he describes the result, the destruction of all life at the Earth's surface, a powerful creation supplanted by the silence of death. Only the whistling of the northern wind and the rumbling of crevasses opening up across the surface of the huge ocean of ice. But there's one huge question that he doesn't answer. Why? Like, why would the Earth just freeze? Plenty of theories are proposed. Maybe the sun had become weaker, or the Earth's axis had suddenly moved, reversing the poles and the tropics. Maybe the Earth had just passed through a colder part of space. Around the same time, James Croll is growing up in rural Scotland. He's had to leave school to work on his family's farm, but he's teaching himself science and math. He leaves the farm and spends the next 20 years working odd jobs, repairing mills, building batteries, managing a hotel, selling tea, selling insurance, carpentry, writing a newspaper, and in 1859, he starts working as a caretaker at a university in Glasgow. The whole time, he's continued to study. He's read all about the Ice Age, and he suspects its cause is astronomical, so he sets out to calculate the relationship between the Earth's orbit and its climate. The shape of the Earth's orbit changes over time. Sometimes it looks close to how you might expect, a circle. But sometimes it looks more like this, elongated with the sun closer to one end than the other. This alternates on roughly a 100,000 year cycle. As it's orbiting the sun, the Earth spins on its own axis as well. That axis is tilted a bit, and exactly how much also changes over time, this time on roughly a 41,000 year cycle. And finally, as it spins, the Earth wobbles, kind of like a spinning top, a roughly 26,000-year cycle. In 1864, Croll publishes his theory, suggesting that changes in the Earth's orbit push it farther from the sun, leading to a colder climate. He also calculates plenty of other factors, wind and ocean currents, changes in precipitation, snow and ice reflecting the sun's energy. The result is something truly ahead of its time. A vision of the Earth's complex and deeply interconnected climate. But in the following decades, scientists start questioning Croll's calculations, and his theory is eventually abandoned. Half a century later, Serbian mathematician Milutin Milankovic modernizes and repopularizes the same ideas. Croll is given due credit, but history has credited Milankovic. All right, cool. Two visionary scientists solving one of the planet's biggest mysteries. It's a great story, but unfortunately, it's missing a really important chapter. And that's what brought me here.
I'm right on the edge of this active glacier here, and looking around, you can see all of these glacial features being made in real time. It's pretty cool. You've got moraines all around the edges of the water, big boulders all over the ground, the rocks are all scratched, and of course, all of this is sitting in this nice U-shaped valley with a nice flat bottom here from the ice.
Jens Esmark was born in Denmark in 1763. He studied theology, natural history, medicine, and later, geology. He became a certified land surveyor, and in 1797, he moved to Norway to work at the Kongsberg Mining School. But in 1805, the mining operations at Kongsberg dried up, and Esmark moved to Oslo. In 1811, Norway's first university opened in Oslo, and Esmark was hired to teach geology. Working here, he took daily measurements of temperature and air pressure, deepening an interest in meteorology and climate. He worked closely with scientists who were out studying Norway's glaciers, and learned a lot about how the ice works. And he traveled the surrounding mountains surveying the landscape, measuring tree lines, snow lines, and summit elevations. He made first ascents of some of Norway's highest peaks, but he was more struck by the country's valleys, with their steep, smoothed-out walls and flat bases. Something must have carved these out, but what could possibly do that? In 1823, Esmark and two of his students are sent out to survey an abandoned copper mine on the Norwegian coast. Here, they notice something out of place. In one of these deep U-shaped valleys, at the end of a lake, is a weird hill. It runs across the valley, wall to wall, long, skinny, and abrupt. He makes a note of it and gets back on the road. The group follows the coast north to inspect another copper mine. Here, they find more landforms they can't explain. Boulders. They're in weird places, and their rock type doesn't match that of the surrounding mountains. Somehow, it seems they came here from somewhere else. At this point, the trip has gotten out of hand. They've been on the road for months and gone way up the west coast. Instead of retracing his steps all the way back to Oslo, Esmark chooses to take a shortcut by cutting across Norway's inland mountains. They cross over a mountain pass that takes them right past the edge of a glacier, and it's probably here that everything starts to click. All of these features they've been seeing on the coast, the U-shaped valleys, the moraines, the boulders, here they can watch this glacier creating them in real time. When he gets back to Oslo, Esmark immediately starts working on a paper about his observations, looking back on all the landscapes he's surveyed and everything he's learned about glaciers and climate in a completely different light. And the next year, he publishes his theory that much of Europe was once covered by a blanket of ice extending all the way down to sea level. He describes how glaciers slide downhill, carving rocks from the mountains and depositing them elsewhere. And he even takes a stab at the cause, suggesting that changes in the shape of the Earth's orbit would push it further from the sun, leading to a colder climate. Esmark's paper is later read and cited by Louis Agassiz. Agassiz publishes his own theory, and it makes a much larger splash. He then devotes much of his career to the study of ice, spending each summer observing glaciers in the Alps and setting up a permanent observatory on a glacier. He ventures into holes in the ice, drills early ice cores, takes samples from deep within the glaciers, and measures their movement. In the following decades, the study of ice is fueled largely by polar expeditions. In 1888, Norwegian explorer Fridtjof Nansen makes the first crossing of the Greenland ice sheet. And in 1911, another Norwegian explorer, Roald Amundsen, is the first to reach the South Pole. By the late 1800s, geologists have mapped the extent of the Ice Age and realized that the Earth has seen not one but several ice ages in its history. Today, the glaciers have gotten smaller, but the ice cores have gotten deeper, reaching thousands of meters down all the way through the ice sheets. Samples of ocean sediments have yielded a climate record reaching back tens of millions of years. Radiocarbon dating and cosmogenic nuclide analysis have revealed the age of glacial landforms. far. Satellites have allowed detailed mapping of the ice sheets, and ground-penetrating radar has revealed the landscapes underneath them. The result is the ability to look back in time, to watch the ice advance, retreat, carve mountains and valleys. But 200 years later, there's one name that you'll only rarely see mentioned. Esmark has been swallowed up, lost within the scale of his discovery. Today, the Ice Age continues in the massive ice sheets covering Greenland and Antarctica, but also in smaller ice caps scattered across the high latitudes. The largest in mainland Europe is right here in Norway.
I want to show you something pretty incredible at the top of this mountain. So I'm making my way up. It's about a 4,000-foot climb, and this entire time I've been absolutely surrounded by the Ice Age.
Here, you can look back in time. You can glimpse this frozen world that Esmark and Agassiz saw. Standing up here, looking out at what's left of Agassiz's ocean of ice, I feel the northern wind. I see the crevasses opening in the ice, but I don't hear the silence of death. I hear water.